If we're going to go develop products or diagnostics, it's going to be a first just by default. So yeah, that's kind of a little bit, hopefully gives some, background on what we're trying to do.
And I mean, I do find it, interesting as well, because there are so many things that have kind of come along, with regards to like cervical cancer, for example. There are things that, that can be done in women's health, to prevent cervical cancer, but then also, there are things that can be done in terms of, long-term treatment as well. And even with that, there are so many other areas in women's health that, are completely untreated and underserved. And it's an amazing landscape, but at the same time, a real, I think, spotlight in terms of the underserved population. So, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's definitely so. We almost have by default taken a contrarian view. It's, if the untapped potential is, all it's been well documented, right, by McKinsey and others of the massive gap. And we're just trying to do our part, and hopefully it models the way for others or collaborations. And, it's maybe a small little pebble in the pond that has some type of a ripple effect for others. And it's, and raised, basically the old adage of, lifting the all boats through by raising the tide. So it's, yeah, we're trying to do our thing. And hopefully, once we're successful in getting one of these products out into serving patients, it will model the way, for others. Yeah. Or give them at least hope that there's a chance, right? Yeah.
Absolutely. So what are some of the key challenges and opportunities that you see in terms of developing therapeutics for underserved populations?
Yeah, that's another podcast, Don. That's let me and I think I said it's well documented, right? So you can pull up, just put up women's health gap, and you'll have tons of articles. And so I don't want to spend time. Let me frame it this way. And I don't know if you're, how many of your audience are Monty Python fans, but there's a skit of Sergeant Major walking up and down the square. I don't know if you're a fan of Monty Python, but
I don't know
I'll
this
give you a little
one,
bit
but
of,
yes, I am, but no.
yeah. So it's there's a Sergeant Major has this plan to march up and down the square with his troops, and he's got all his troops lined up, and he announces to everyone, what we're gonna do today is march up and down the square. And then he says, unless somebody here has something else on their mind that they want to do. And the first person raises his hand and says, well, to be honest, he goes, I'd love to be at home with the wife and kids. He goes, right, off with you. And this happens throughout his whole troop. And at the end, the only person that is left is Sergeant Major walking up and down the square. That's how I feel in the women's health space. We have spoken to with our bankers. I'd have to ask Stephen. I'm sure he's reached out to well over 300. And the responses have come from, pretty benign to pretty malignant. And what does that do to? So some of the challenges are that, the LPs are, it's not a mandate for them. Even Roche, we were talking to, and they're in women's health, right? But now they're looking to get into GLP-1, right? Because that's the next thing, or immunotherapy. So it becomes this kind of chasing the what is hot, and the money flows there. And unfortunately, talking to some of the private equity guys, one that we go to for just wise counsel. He said, I'll tell you what some of the challenges for women's health companies are. There's no blockbusters. And until you have a blockbuster, Wall Street is not going to take it seriously. And that trickles throughout the ecosystem. And it's kind of this, whether it's a myth or true, it doesn't matter because that's the perception. Right. So, given that backdrop, again, going back to my first comment about don't do it, is okay. So, knowing that those are all the constraints and you're going to get rejected, how do you position yourself? What messaging do you do? So, we didn't start out to be a women's health company. And I think that's, but it's the opportunity is, like as you said, it's completely underserved, which means there's a huge market potential, and it's up to us to communicate that optimism, and taking a little page out, and I'm Canadian, I'll take a little page out of one of your presidential candidates, Kamala Harris, who said, "Let's turn the chapter, and let's stop talking about being victims of underfunding, under research." And talk about the opportunities that it provides. And when we talk about those type of messages and some of the things that we've done, it gets traction. And it's not that it doesn't exist, all those problems. It's just reframing it. And that's why if you go on our website, it says redefining what is possible. Because when somebody says, "Oh, you're a women's health company," I said, "What does that mean to you?" And their definition is quite narrow. And so I think anybody that's working in this space, I think, can take that opportunity to, in their own way, to redefine what is possible and reframe that opportunity, and show them, hey, it's basics. Comes back to business 101, right? Here's the market opportunity. Here's how we're going to execute, and this is why. And you surround yourself with the people who are going to be buying it, paying for it. And all the same things that they would look at other ones. So for those investors who are looking for those, let's say, real 8-10 times return, it may be possible within this space where you have such untapped potential. So.
It is always, I mean, just to sort of, share a little of my perspective as well. So, I mean, I sit on the executive, team of a women's health diagnostic company that is newly funded and, fighting all of these same battles. And it is very interesting to me that every, sort of investor presentation that we have and things like that leads to a room full of men, right? So it's, I mean, we're men, the guys that, sort of founded the company, are both male. And then, they hired, myself and then, one other individual as executives on the, in the group. Then we wind up, in a room typically with other investors that are essentially, also men. And I always sort of, I liken everything back to, I have two daughters, I have a wife, I have a mother that passed away of ovarian cancer. So, I mean, all of
Oh,
this
sorry to
stuff
hear
is
that.
very sort of central to my life, right? And then we start these conversations because we're a diagnostic company. Our whole goal is to try and diagnose this stuff early. And they're like, but the woman could also just turn around and go for a blood test. And I'm like, that's another appointment. It's not eating the next morning. It's going back to the doctor's office versus immediately getting an answer on this thing. And they're like, but people do this all the time. It's not that hard. And I'm like, yeah, but I mean, for me, whenever I have to go for a blood test, it's irritating. I don't have to eat breakfast. I can't eat breakfast the next day. I got to make sure that I get over there, as early as possible and, try and start my day right afterwards versus something the physician could just do in their office. And I do, I mean, we have these sort of, back and forth conversations. Then I typically walk out and just, share the same news with my wife. She's like, just invite me. I'll come in there and tell them I don't want to have to go back. And I oftentimes find it interesting that people just can't put themselves in somebody else's shoes, right? So that's, I mean, that's the, kind of my, my own personal journey with this as well is just, sort of put yourself in somebody else's shoes. It doesn't matter if you're a man or woman. It's not that hard to sort of envision the fact that you living this, and especially if you're sick, would not be pleasant.
It's tough.